Yes, hello everyone. So yes, I'm co-founder of Game Studio Next Level. And so the title of the speech is Path to Success. Is it working? Yes, so the agenda of the speech is as follows. Short bio of the company, so you know what is this Next Level thingy. Then how we achieved the first step of success, because this lecture is about success. Then what is the next step of success? And what the hell we're doing to achieve it? Very simple. Before that, I'd like to ask a question. What is success? Because it's a very subjective thing. For instance, someone might have like the second wealthiest company in the world, and he would feel like a failure because he's not the first one. While someone else might go bankrupt in the second day of his or her company. I think it's possible. Why not? And still feel like he has achieved something because he just did it. He managed to create his company. So success is kind of subjective. Nonetheless, I tried to find one relatively objective criteria, what could be called success. According to Harvard Business School data, well, out of all startups, on average, 80% fail to return on investment. So if we, and luckily we have happened to be in those 20%, yeah, we're success, yeah, it's cool, we're doing great. What is this next level, really? What have we achieved? What we're doing at the moment? We're a 2.5 years young company. We have developed 6 games, and 3 more are in the works. Approximately 16, 17 people are working with our games. And we have published in 9 social networks and in 6 countries. I'd like to mention 2 of our projects for which we are best known. It's social game Oceania, which is this typical social game where you're on a tropical island and you make it more beautiful and do things like that. We're very proud of it because it has been for almost 2 years and the most profiting social game in Belgium, social network. And we've been developing it all the time, and it's kind of this our proud of this project. Another successful thing we have is Fix, which is, we're not ashamed of it, it's a Bejeweled Blitz clone, which we saw the idea, we took it, improved, and published again, at the LGMLV. And yes, it was a success too, because it became the most popular game, the LGM, and still is, and it still brings in steady income, because the game is very replayable. So these two are our biggest hits. So a small kind of a recap. What we did right to achieve these things. This is more information for those who are probably thinking about starting something. We had experience mixed with idealism? I don't know how it's pronounced. Does anyone know? No? Okay, never mind. The idea, we came together, game development hobbyists who all were making games in their spare time, and we had this idea. Oh, there's lots of crap at the LGMLV. Like everyone has gone there and made the games, and they're all horrible. We're gamers. We should know better how to do it than businessmen, right? And we came together and mixed it with experience, which was mine actually, because I worked at the LGM for 1 year, and I had knowledge what projects worked, what failed, and had more of an insight into this industry. And it worked nicely because we created this game, Oceania, which wasn't just a small project, it was a project with which we wanted to achieve lots. Another thing, very important thing, is intensive short-term work. Probably everyone knows it, but there is a great probability if you don't finish the game in a certain number of months, say 4, 5, or 6, then you might not finish it at all. So we worked for 10 hours a day, very intensely, for 3.5 months. Another important thing was focusing on long-term qualities and goals. As you probably have seen, social games, free-to-play games, have this classical income curve where it spikes in the beginning and then it goes down. And then it's kind of dead. And we thought that we can do better than that. We watched our role models were the big companies like Blizzard or Valve, who develop and support the games for tens of years. I was astonished that I think a couple of years ago, Blizzard published a new patch for StarCraft 1. StarCraft 1 was published in 1998. We thought they're doing something right, and we wanted to do the same. So we focused very much on continuing to develop our games. As a result, we didn't really know it, but as we learned it later, we had created a service instead of a product. And this is very important. This is this kind of new idea. If you're making a freemium game, you have to make it like a service. Like you should run it like you run a shop. It always has to be ready. You always have to respond to your customers. You have to make loyal customers so they love it and they return to it and they purchase its services. So kind of by accident, kind of by intuition, we managed to do it. So these could be things that led to this first step of success. What is the next step? So you're this company which has published a couple of games successfully, and you have a steady cash flow. What do you do now? Well, the first idea which comes to mind, of course, is world dominance. I believe everyone has this idea that when you're the indie, you start up, in the end you want to surpass Angry Birds or World of Warcraft or something like that. That's very silly. So let's be a bit more pragmatic. So after the first step, you're learning to be a medium-sized company. We'll talk a bit about that more. You're innovating and experimenting. And then you're still dreaming about creating one or more world-class games which can surpass current market leaders, and in the end, of course, world dominance. You're still thinking about it, just one step at a time. So, what are we doing to achieve it? Yes, learning to be a medium-sized company. So, it's a very important adjustment. When you start from 4 guys just sitting by the computers for 10 hours a day, and now you have this huge office with lots of people, inevitably it bogs you down, because you have all the projects that you have to update, there's lots of legacy things, and at the same time you want to develop something else. So you get more meetings, you get more interruptions. It requires lots of effort. So in the end, at some point, we realized that we need a company manager, and we hired one, and now she runs the company for us, and we're just doing something there. Secondly, attracting more talent. 4 people can't support and create new games at the same time, so we needed to find more people. Luckily, we had more enthusiasts who were game creating hobbyists, and we attracted him by getting a contract to make a game about forestry. by this Latvian state forestry institution, and the game turned out to be pretty cool, I think. It's kind of a detailed simulation of 7-year cycle of forestry, which at the same time has to be a competitive game for schools, so schools can compete, and the best school wins in the end. And the project turned out to be pretty nice, even though, of course, instead of the planned 3-month schedule, we got something to 6 and 7 months. But that's always so. Then, what else we've been doing? Trying out new stuff. We've always loved education, because education is very nice. It's kind of this investment in the future. And I've always believed that games and education goes very well together. So I was glad to hear that in Holland these things are progressing so nicely. In Latvia, I believe we're still kind of far behind. Nonetheless, we got a partner. Actually, the partner wanted to make 10 educational games, and we were interested, and we jumped in. But the task was to create multi-platform games, so they run on PC, iPhone, Android, and smart TV. So as a result, it was lots of work, and it was horrible because we had to remake the same game 4 times, each time in a different technology, including HTML5, which we realized is the future, but not the now. And the game was too graphically intensive, so couldn't support it. And in the end, we chose some kind of compromise solution because of that damned smart TV, and later on the smart TV was dropped, and we had our heads in our hands. But nonetheless, we're still content with these two projects, which are about teaching fractions, a kind of like Chain Bejeweled game mixed with a educational fraction teaching game. We're proud of it because at the moment, among all these 10 planned games, out of which 2 we had to make, we're the only ones who made them, so we feel pretty cool. And we learned lots and lots about engines and cross-platforming and etc. And we've been doing this, experimenting with gameplay design. We created kind of completely original game, which is a mesh of tower defense and card drafting game. And the mechanics are pretty interesting, but we developed it for a long time. It's a synchronous multiplayer game. Basically, it is a card game, but with towers and monsters and this kind of battlefield thing going on. Nonetheless, for now, probably we made a mistake. We made a too big project, too original, because it flopped terribly. Probably because the monetization was thought out poorly. A hint for you, VIP accounts don't work. Maybe in some games, definitely not in this one. And it lacked some kind of development for retention. Also, synchronous games are kind of difficult because for them to happen, you need a certain amount of people to play it. You don't have this solo experience, which is always risky. Nonetheless, we're still planning to remake the game, identify the problems, we're already working on it, and make something else. And finally, which is probably the most important thing, learning more about the business. We've gone to some conferences, we went to Winter Nights Mobile Games and to Casual Connect, and to get the feel of the game industry, what's going on, what's happening, what we're going to face abroad. And there's one thing for sure that we learned. It's all about data. Whatever you do, test it. Whatever you do, gather statistics, learn new things. The feel was that this industry is very difficult, very hard. There's lots of competition, and you have to make very informed decisions. For instance, this one of these grand games, VUGA, I talked with the representative, and he told me that they are prototyping for 6 months, just searching for the right game mechanics, and only afterwards they're building the game. So there's this kind of sciencey, very, very rigid testing attitude. Of course, only big companies can afford it, but nonetheless, this has to be taken in mind, and so we're learning to gather data, learning to be more smart about what we do. Also, we're making something simple, but with some twists, because we need to keep up our cash flow. I won't tell anything about this game, but it will launch soon. And in the end, still, as I said, it's about conquering the world, whether we can do it or not. But at heart, we're still idealists, meaning that we're not that interested in building a stable, run-of-the-mill game business company, because then we could work with some contracts or something like that, or work with some kind of very reliable casual game, I don't know, methods. We still have this idea that you have to create something mind-blowing and something very cool, something that improves on what is at the moment at the lead and etc. And so we're toiling all the time at our next big thing project, parallel to all these other things. So we're working. Here's a small concept fragment which won't tell you much, but some ideas will arise from it. I can't tell you much about this game. There's lots of it, and hopefully it will be super fun. But nonetheless, it's about this attitude that in the end, we want to make something mind-blowing, and all the rest is just means to support this aim. Thank you for your attention.
Okay.
No questions.
No, but I have. Uh-huh. So, how do you live today? As I understand, there are two successful projects for you, which were like before. Are you like getting money still from them and support our early team?
Yes, we're still getting money from projects published in Latvia. Also, we're getting from abroad, where we've published. I have to admit, we're still largest portion of our income is still coming from Latvia. Nonetheless, gradually we're expanding also in Poland, in Russia, and then in Lithuania and other places. But yes, they are feeding us these projects, and so we're updating them and polishing them and improving them.
Okay, so hope to see the next big thing from you guys.
Thanks.